Song of Solomon, chapter 6, verse 13. Solomon's Song, chapter 6. Verse 13. Everything that God created, he stepped back and looked on it and saw that it was good. The highest pinnacle of his creation is the relationship between the Holy Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and his church. She says in chapter 1 and verse 5, I am black. And in verse 6, she said, don't look at me. That's her considering herself in her sin and her afflictions. But he tells her in chapter 6, in verse number 4, thou art beautiful, O my love. They say beauty is in the eye of beholders. I think they're exactly right. I think there are those who think they have no loveliness at all, that if they were to see themselves with the eye of God's love, they would understand how valuable they are to the Lord. Satan will have you to try to keep on trying to work to be loved, but God's love is not an if love. It's not a when love. It's not a because love. He won't love you when you get right or when you get better or because you are something or if you do something. God just loves you, period, because God is love. And to give you himself is to give you the highest degree and the most pure love you can ever imagine. It will believe in you. It will hope in you. It will not seek its own. It will seek you and your good. It will endure everything you throw at it. It will not be puffed up. It doesn't matter concerning you and that which you are in your own mind. It matters what you are in God's purposes for you. The human body is more important than we've ever been allowed to know. When we read the Song of Solomon, chapter 7, verse 1 through 9, you're going to start thinking about, if you're male, you're thinking about the female physically. If you're a female, you'll be thinking about the male physically. We have been robbed of the privilege and opportunity, and we should pray right now in your heart of hearts. You don't have to bow your little head and close your little eyes and fold your little hands. Just cry out to God in your heart right now. Lord, this book's not about me. It's about you. So help me, the Lord, that I might see the spirituality of that which God is seeing in the church. The human body is an amazing thing. God dwelt eternally without any visibility. I don't mean that he couldn't see. I mean you couldn't see him. There was nothing visible about him. In Genesis chapter 1 and verse 26, the Holy Spirit speaks to the rest of the Trinity and use a plural. I think it's a pronoun. And God said, let us make something to reveal our image. Do you know what that was? Now the King James says, man. But if you say that, you're talking about a male. That's what it was. But what it's saying is, for God to step out of invisibility into visibility and cause everything that he gives existence and distinction from himself to know about him, he's saying, let's make ourselves a human body. Insomuch that God is now engrossed, obsessed, excuse me, Lord, I don't know how to say it. He is focused upon the human body. He did not choose things that I can't even imagine because they were never chosen by which to display himself. The songwriters say, I see him in the sunset, I see him in the lily, I see him in the baby smile, I see him in the... Those are things that you know about and you think are beautiful, so you compare God to that. But what about all the things that script writers and poets and novelists could never think of, could never fathom? You've never heard of it. God could have appeared and made himself in his appearance in things I can't even imagine. But he didn't. He said, let us make the human body. And in that human body, I will display the image of my glory. That is an amazing thing. He set up, Hebrews chapter 10, he set up a system of sacrifice. It takes up the first part of your Bible. You got to know what animals you can sacrifice, what animals you can't sacrifice. You've got to know what kind of incense to put on the altar, or you can get killed like Nadab and Abihu for making up your own home brew, and God will kill you for it. You've got to know what fabric to wear when you go into the holy place. Linen, not cotton or wool. The laws of sacrifice are unbelievable. Every little detail concerning the tabernacle, the knops, the snuffers, the dishes, the badger skins, the tapestry, the pomegranates, the bales, everything in detail, unbelievable, and it lasted for 4,000 years, and then one thing displaced it all. Hebrews chapter 10. Verse 5, wherefore, when he, Christ, came into a human body, when incarnation took place within the tissues of the humanity of Mary, and the Holy Spirit moved upon the tenderness of that inner womb, when he cometh into the world, he saith, first thing on the mind of God with a human body, sacrifice and offerings thou wouldest not. Would you finish it for me?
But a body hast thou prepared.
It's over and done with. Moses is obsolete. He's brought you to Christ, and that's it. Bury him. What replaced the entirety of the system of the law? One human body. Amazing, isn't it? Satan now is attracted to the human. In Matthew 12, He lives inside a body, human body. The fellow has an onslaught of morality and casts out Satan, but he's not filled with God. And so in verse 43 of Matthew 12, the unclean spirit that's cast out of the man's body, walking through dry places, next word,
seeking.
Seeking rest and findeth none. Then he saith, I will return into two words.
My house.
What was his house? A human body. The human body is the house of the devil, from whence I came out. And when he is come, he findeth it empty, swept, and garnished. The soul-winning movement set up more people for hell than any other thing I know of. They quit drinking, they quit cussing, they quit smoking, they quit running around, they quit this, that, and the other, all kind of cheating and lying, but they didn't get saved. You just had to make a decision, walk an aisle, sign a card, tell Billy Graham, thank you, buddy. And next thing you know, America is now in the mess she's in. Then goeth he and taketh with him seven other spirits more wicked than himself, and they enter in and dwell there. Where? In the human body. Religion without salvation and its effect upon man causes the last state of that man to be worse than the first. Even so shall it be also unto this wicked generation. Because God is, excuse me, I don't mean to be disrespectful, Lord, obsessed with the human body. Because God would take his holy essence, the pureness and the holiness and the warmth and the light and the glory that's within him, who is in whom is no darkness at all, dwelling in the light which no man can approach unto, and who had his son daily as his delight, Proverbs chapter 8. He said, let's materialize. Let's come forth into visibility. Holy Spirit, you go into that room. There's a drawing board in there. You sit down and you draw things you think we ought to be. Son, you go over yonder and I'll stay here. There were no options. Let us make man in our image. There was no consideration of anything else. The human body. In fact, the Son had been in it already without it even being created, for he was as a lamb slain from the foundation of the world. And it was his entrance into submissiveness of the human body and coming and being susceptible to death that set up God to make man as a living sacrifice. That's what you're supposed to be. God being so given to the human body, it draws Satan to it. Satan wants to counterfeit and mess up everything God has. Satan is a reactionary. He is not an originator. He is an imitator. And I don't like his taters. So he's now drawn to the human body. Jude, verse 9. The book of Jude. Verse number 9. Yet Michael, the archangel, when contending with whom?
The devil.
The devil, disputing about two words.
The body.
You say, what was that all about? Only thing I know is the devil wanted that body. And the only reason I knew he wanted that body was because the Bible said so. And the mind behind it, I can only surmise, being an ignorant man and a sinful man at that, but I only surmise that the devil wanted it because it was important to God. Because the thief cometh not, no other reason, to kill. You can't kill that which has not been made alive. He's going to act on what God's done. To steal. You can't steal that which is not produced. And to destroy. But I am come, Jesus said, that they might have life. The devil wants a human body. People stupidly, ignorantly, dumbly say, if I go to hell, I'll have a lot of company. A lot of my buddies are going to be down there. You ain't going to have no thought of your buddies. You're going to be filled with so many demons. You're going to be tormented throughout all eternity. You ain't never going to have no peace because the devil wants that body. The incarnation of God is matched by the possession of demon spirits to those who reject the person of God. It is an amazing thing. Daniel chapter 2. Daniel chapter 2. God Almighty will display the Gentile kingdoms. Well, we need to get face page or something, you know. We need some computers and we need some graphic designers and such. And let's see if we can't set this thing. He chose a human body. Going to show Nebuchadnezzar, or whoever he was, Nebuchadnezzar, the entirety of the Gentile nations and kingdoms. He gives him a dream. He dreams about a body, but he don't understand it. It's right in his face. It's obvious, but he don't understand it. He has to get a man that knows God, that walks with God inside of a human body, a man named Daniel. And Daniel says in Daniel 2 and verse 31, thou, O king, sawest and behold a great image. This great image whose brightness was excellent. God manifested the brightness of his glory in his image of Jesus Christ. Or in his image upon Jesus Christ. Or in his image of Jesus Christ. This great image whose brightness was excellent stood before thee, and the form thereof was terrible. Ooh! Steven Spielberg, you know, Stephen King, horror writers, ooh, monsters. Yeah, it was really horrible. It was me and you, a human body. But it's listed as being excellent in its brightness and terrible in its form. We don't really know God anymore. We've lost the whole concept of God. We're in a mess. We've got a little old system of theology that we rattle around inside of our brain and think we're great Christians. God said the world is getting worse and worse and worse and worse. Silver, then gold, then brass, then iron, then mud. This image's head was of fine gold. His breast, we're going to look at the breast in chapter 7 of Song of Solomon, but we dare not look at that until we see this and try to get our minds sanctified again. His head was of fine gold. His breast and his arms were of silver. His belly and his thighs of brass. His legs of iron, his feet part of iron and part of clay. The head of gold is the Chaldeans. Verse 38, the last sentence. Thou art this head of gold. After thee shall another, verse 39, kingdom inferior to thee. Shall arise another kingdom inferior to thee. Silver, the Persians. And another third kingdom of brass, the Greeks. It's going to be split into two thighs. It was exactly like God said, the eastern and the western kingdoms. And then it said, and the fourth kingdom, verse 40, Romans, shall be strong as iron. And that's the legs and his feet, part of iron and part of clay. For as much as iron breaketh in pieces and subdueth all things, and as iron that breaketh all things, shall it break in pieces and bruise. And then you saw the feet and the toes. The Roman Empire shattered into 10 different generals trying to reach the authority of Caesar again. And it was exactly 10, which is what you got on your feet. And God is showing us the entire world of the Gentiles by looking in the mirror. And then in verse 44, and in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. And the kingdom shall not be left to other people. Nobody's going to assume it like they did. The Persians took over the Chaldeans, and the Greeks took over from the Persians, and the Romans took over from the Greeks. But during the Roman Empire, there's going to come a kingdom. The kingdoms of our Lord have become the kingdoms of our God, and he shall reign forever and ever. The kingdom of Jesus Christ that you have to be born again to see and to enter, and that by the Holy Spirit, John 3, 3, 5, and 8. And how did he appear? Revelation chapter number 1. I turned to see the voice. Revelation 1 and verse 12. And I turned to see the voice that spake with me. And being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. I saw the churches. And in the midst, well, two or three are gathered, that's where I'll be. In the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, Son of Man, Son of Man, God obsessed with the human body. The Son of Man clothed with a garment down to the foot. We studied her feet already in Psalm 7. And girt about the paps with a golden girdle. We're going to see her paps, her breasts later. His head and his hairs, he's already complimented her on that. We're white like wool, as white as snow. He's already said, turn your eyes away from me, because with one of your eyes you have overcome me. And his eyes were as a flame of fire. Everything here is the development of and the manifestation of the purposes of God when he first said, let us display our image And let us make the human body in order to display the invisibility of God Almighty. And so everything that he made to express himself. So when we look at Song of Solomon chapter 7, we are not looking at the physical body. We're looking from the physical body into the purposes of God in their design. His eyes are not literal fire, although Hebrews 12:29 said our God is a consuming fire. And although he said, I'm the light of the world and the light of life. But if you are around the nature of fire that purifies and warms, you understand that for have Jesus fasten his eyes upon you is a very warming and illuminating thing. It wasn't just the rooster that convicted the apostle. It was Jesus looking upon him. When he saw the eyes of Jesus, he went out and wept bitterly. If by some small margin of a chance today, Almighty God was to allow you to feel the warmth and the purifying agency of the eyes of God through the silly, goofy, little stupid efforts of this clod of a man that stands before you, you will know exactly what I'm talking about. But it's probable that you won't get anything more than a confusing message. It really wasn't what we were thinking we were going to get when we turned to Song of Solomon chapter 7. It'll probably be hidden from you, and you'll probably go home in worse shape than you were. But if God were to open your heart and let the gaze of God warm your being, you would understand that when we look at the human form, we're not looking at the human form. We're looking at God's purposes for manifesting himself in the human form. And now you'll begin to understand why the doctrine of the resurrection is so important and why it had such an effect every time the apostles preached it. Because he said, I shall take your vile body. I believe it's Philippians 3:21. I may be wrong. You can look it up. Maybe it's 2:21. Anyhow, it's in Philippians. It's verse 21, whatever it is. He shall take our vile body and change it and make it into the likeness of his glorious body. Let us take our invisible, glorious essence and put it into visibility. What do we want to do? The Trinity is in total agreement with itself. We will make man. That's how it started. How shall it end? We know not how we shall appear, but we do know this. When he shall appear, then we shall attain appearance and be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Seeing him in his glorified body, which he hasn't obtained the fullness of that glory yet. He's still in mediation, mediatorial glory. He's going to get into glory of God all in all. And when you see that, it'll change you. The beginning was man. The ending is be like him, the perfect man. It is amazing. His feet were like unto fine brass, part of the body that God showed Nebuchadnezzar was of brass, as if they burned in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters, and had in his right hand, the hand of his power, seven stars. That is the ministry of the churches. The seven stars, verse 20b, are the angels, the messengers of the seven churches. He has those God-called preachers in his right hand. And out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword. He don't have a sword literally in his mouth. You know that's not. That's the reason I want you to read this, because it's not just going to be talking about the physical members of her body. I'm not here to help you with your pornography. I'm here, God willing, to help you rise up and see the purposes of God in what he sees in the human body. The result of seeing God in his purposes for his body caused John to do something in verse 17 of chapter 1 of the Revelation that he had never done. And he had walked with his human body. He had slept with him. He had undergone persecution with him. He had passed out the loaves and fishes from him. He had heard him pray. He had heard him say, "Woman," to Mary, his own mother, "Behold, thy son." John's now your son. And John, "Now behold, she's your mother now." He had heard that. But he never had happen to him what happened to him in verse 17 of chapter 1 of the Revelation. Would you read me the first verse, excuse me, first sentence in Revelation 1:17?
"And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as his dead."
I fell at his what?
Feet.
And his feet were not feet. They were like fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace. He did not see feet. He saw the awesome, perfect holiness of God's judgment, putting his feet on everything under his domain. He sees him with the eye of the Spirit. That's what we need before we read Song of Solomon chapter 7. We need to be overcome by the spirituality of the body parts, not for what they appear to us in the physical, but that which God determined them to be in the spiritual. In the book of Joshua chapter 5, you don't have to turn there. Joshua's fixing to go up against his first Canaanite city. And God shows him one thing and gives him the power, the courage, the authority to launch this attack. As yet, his army of farmers, dragging their kids and their wives and their billy goats, their kneading pans and their tents, and all that stuff they had with him, he's got to launch an attack on men of war in Canaan. God showed him one thing. "I saw a man with a sword in his hand." And he being in the mind of the flesh, he said, "Can I count you as one to fight with us or one to fight against us? Are you for us or are you for them?" And the one with the sword in his mouth speaks to Joshua with the sword in his hand and said, "I'm not here for either one. I'm here to be your captain. Now get in line." Joshua did what John did. He fell on his face before him and recognized by seeing one man the holy essence of God Almighty revealed to him would be all he needed to launch his campaign against the Canaanites. And he did a pretty good job. In Ezekiel chapter number 1, You can turn there if you want to. Ezekiel chapter number 1. Ezekiel sees a whirlwind come out of the north. So did they in Acts chapter 2. A whirlwind come from above. Suddenly there was a rush, the sound of a rushing mighty wind. It was the Holy Ghost. And he says in verse 4, "Now look and behold, a whirlwind came out of the north, a great cloud and a fire enfolding itself." If you look up that word enfolding, it means receiving itself. We would say it was billowing, and a brightness was about it, and out of the midst thereof as the color of amber, out of the midst of the fire. And the color of amber is the color of God's glory. Verse 2 of chapter 8, "And I beheld in lo a likeness as the appearance of fire, from the appearance of his loins even downward, fire, and from his loins even upward, as the appearance of brightness, as the color of amber." In verse 4 of chapter 8 of Ezekiel, "And behold, the glory of the God of Israel was there, according to the vision that I saw in chapter 1. The amber is the glory of God. So here is this amber fire of glory coming towards Ezekiel. And he keeps on looking. And in verse 26 of Ezekiel chapter 1, he sees one thing. There is a firmament, verse 25, over the heads of the angelic hosts. It's a pavement of sapphires. The mighty archangel who is to become the devil stands immediately under that, and he walks upon the stones of fire. But there's a pavement above him. His head doesn't quite reach to the bottom of the pavement. There's something more glorious up there. And on that sapphire pavement was a throne. Verse 26, Ezekiel 1. "And above the firmament that was over their heads was the likeness of a throne, as the appearance of a sapphire stone. And upon the likeness of the throne was," you finish it, "and upon the likeness of the throne was,"
"the likeness as the appearance of a man.
Wonder who that was. "And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts," for the first time, praising God and looking upon God in flesh. What were they looking at? A man. And none of them said, "Shoot, I thought it really be something." It is something. God manifest in the flesh. Glory to God in the highest. Listen, you, the angels invisible in this atmosphere right now are probably getting more out of this than you human beings. It's because you human beings have been so dulled down, you don't have any concept of what I'm trying to bring to you this morning, and you don't have any of the importance like you should have and the weight of what you are before Almighty God. Thank you. The angel's going to have to get out of the way when you go strolling into heaven. Demons and the powers and principalities and so forth are going to have to go scurrying out of the way when Christ's body marches into eternal glory. Because we cannot see God in these ways, there's a reluctance of your pastor to take you further on into Psalm 7. We have looked, and the title of our lesson is from verse 16 of chapter 13, that we may look upon thee. We have looked upon her feet with shoes. We have looked at the joints of her thighs, because the thighs are those which direct the feet, like jewels and the work of hands of a cunning workmanship. Today I'm fully prepared to preach to you 2 full hours on the navel and the belly. But I could not leave my house without God cautioning me and showing me these things that came so fast I had to jot them down on an envelope. You talking about fresh bread, honey. You getting it this morning. If you don't want it, and if you ain't going to get it, you're going to be in deep trouble, because this is God manifesting himself to us. I never heard nothing like this. I'm having to preach it to myself. I'm sorry that I don't have a better pastor. And I'm sorry you don't have a better pastor. But listen, dear friend, if God offered you a cool drink of water in a soup can, would you take it if you was dying of thirst? Well, here it is, the old soup can up here. How did God appear to Abraham? 3 men. 3 men. Explain that to me, Lucy. You got a lot of explaining to do, Lucy. Listen, you explain to me how God, one God, can appear to Abraham at his tent door as 3 men as he goes down to Sodom. If you can't couple that with Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, each one having a separate body. My job is useless. I can't help you if you can't see that. Daniel chapter 9 and verse 21. Daniel chapter 9. You just get one little phrase if you want to help me read it. Daniel chapter 9 and verse 21. When I stop, read me to the next comma. It's just 4 words. Daniel 9, 21. Yea, whilst I was speaking in prayer.
Even the man Gabriel.
What? Don't hand me that. Gabriel ain't no man. Now read it again. Do it right this time.
Even the man Gabriel.
Oh, you're going to stick with it, are you? Oh, I say, yeah, you're right. What? Fathom that. This mighty archangel, who's never going to be a man, who was never intended to be a man. He was created for what he is. He will never be more or less. But to show the importance of him, it raised that angel up to a higher degree of glory. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host looking in that little old bassinet and praising God and saying glory to God in the... This is God's highest glory, being in human form. Wow. It's the man, Gabriel. Dear soul, the first human being ever made was made by literally the hands of God, which he did not have at that time. I can't explain that either, Lucy. God formed man of the dust of the earth and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And man became God, leaning over into that clay nose and the issuance of the wind, the breath of God brought life into him. He did not form a tool. He did not form a designer or a doctor or a sculptor. Say, this is what I got in mind to make this and leave it to them and then come. God formed him himself. That's how important the human body is. After that, God showed his sovereignty by making man in three other ways. He made the woman, Eve, with the help and the aid of a man, Adam, but without the aid of a woman. The man had the baby. Third way, he made Cain and Abel with the aid of a man and a woman, Adam and Eve. But he made the body of Jesus Christ with the aid of a woman and not with the aid of a man. God is showing you that it doesn't matter how man gets here. It matters that God is the only source of his existence. After this, he invests the reproduction of the human tissues deep within the darkness of the female womb. And he makes sure that we understand Galatians 3:16, thy seed, which is Christ, must be interjected within that womb by the male alone. And so when he says, the Holy Ghost shall be with you and shall be in you, he is speaking of the great mystery concerning Christ and the church. And he made that male to be able to penetrate into that darkness and to ejaculate within it the seed of life. And then within that darkness of that womb, God secretly, mysteriously, and somebody asked in Job or Psalms, I think it was Job, how do we know how the tissues are formed in the body? I don't know what becomes fingernails and what becomes eyeball. I don't understand how some of it could be brain and other a big toe. How can some of it be so hard as a tooth or a bone and the other be so soft as the eyelid? I don't know. You don't either. Doctors don't either. I don't care what they say. They don't know. It holds it up to God. He's the one that did it. He's the one that does it. It can't be done by any other than God in his person. He set this thing forth. He controls it. It cannot be done except God allows it.
Oh, yes, we have artificial insemination. Yeah, and how many times has that not worked? And how many times has a woman had a litter of babies like a litter of puppies? We can't make sure anything we do is going to be right except God does.
Right. Amen.
Well, lady, I'm sorry you finna have nine kids at one time. Everything we get in on, we mess up. Preacher, what are you preaching about? I don't know. I'm preaching about the human body. And I want you to understand this. The first work of God concerning the human body was to separate it from the earth. The Lord God formed man from the dust of the earth. He separated the humanity of mankind from the dirt. The last thing he shall ever do is separate mankind from the dirt. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. Grandkids, we want to show you something. You probably ain't going to like it. And you're going to say icky poo or whatever grandkids say anymore. But this is the plot where Grandmama and I will be interred. No, buried. Okay, just say it. Now, right over there is great-grandmama. And right there is great-granddaddy. And then there's great-great-granddaddy and great-great. And here's Aunt Sue and here's Uncle Bill. And but, Grandmama, I thought you said your mama was in heaven. Well, she is. Well, who's in there? It's her. Got some more explaining to do. Flesh and blood cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. What are you going to do when you got the sense of smell in eternity, but you can't sneeze because you ain't got no nose? What are you going to do when you got the desire to taste, but you ain't got no tongue? What are them people doing up there? Well, are they people or spirits? I don't know. They're souls, I think. But I know one thing. The only one that's ever going to put them all back together again. Because all the king's horses and all the king's men are never going to be able to put that Humpty Dumpty back together again. It's going to take the power of the one that separated human beings from the dirt to begin with to separate their bodies from the dirt and put them back with their spirits without messing up one. But my great uncle was a sailor and he fell overboard and the sharks ate him. Yeah, and then some amoeba or bacteria or whatever ate the shark. How you gonna put all that back? That's my point. It is just as impossible, humanly thinking, to get those bodies resurrected from the dirt, from the ocean, from the bottom of the ocean, from being digested by a shark at the end of the age, as it was to form man out of the dust of the earth to start with. But God said, this is my image.